Mathematics, as we know it, can be broadly divided into a few areas based on what they study. Algebra studies algebraic structures, such as groups, rings, and fields, and how they relate to each other through homomorphisms. Topology studies geometric objects, and the properties of which that are preserved under continuous deformation, such as homeomorphisms. Analysis studies, broadly speaking, functions and their generalizations, and how they perform under various constraints. And logic studies the properties of different systems of formal logic. The boundaries between these areas, of course, are not clear-cut. On this map, category theory is the coast joining the ocean of logic with the caliphate of algebra, which is certainly true as a part of its function. However, it is much more than that. Category theory serves as a bridge between different kingdoms of mathematics. Instead of studying things, it encourages a shift to studying the underlying structure of the things. Because of this, it's often very useful to use category theory to ask about the invariance of the structures, i.e., what remains unchanged. Because of this nature, category theory is often regarded as the unifying language of math, sometimes called the mathematics of mathematics. For example, topology theory establishes a connection between algebraic geometry and logic, which uses an insane amount of category theory. And it makes sense, because generalization and abstraction is the bread and butter of mathematicians, so category theory arises naturally. But before we continue talking, as good mathematicians, let's talk about definitions. In set theory, we study sets, and we have functions with specified domains and codomains that tell us how the sets interact with each other. In group theory, groups are the objects that we're concerned with, and we use group homomorphisms to study how groups interact with each other. In topology, we have our topological spaces, and we use continuous functions to study how one space is mapped to another. As good mathematicians, we ask, how can we generalize the structure? This gives rise to objects and morphisms, and together they make categories. More precisely speaking, a category consists of a collection of objects and a collection of morphisms, such that each morphism has a specified domain and a codomain. Each object has an identity morphism, and composition makes sense for morphisms. That is, if you have a morphism F that maps from X to Y, and a G that maps from Y to Z, then G composed with F should map from X to Z. In addition, we have two axioms. The identity morphism makes sense. In other words, taking the identity morphism on X and then F should be the same as taking F and then the identity morphism on Y. They should both equal to just F. And also, composition of morphism is associative, meaning the order of composition should not matter, whether we do H composed with G first or G composed with F first. In fancy language, we say the composition law is associative and unital, with the identity morphisms serving as two-sided identities. It is precisely these morphisms that serve as the defining characteristic of category theory. As defined here, morphisms tell us the relationships between the objects in a category. A special morphism is called an isomorphism, which is exactly what you think it is. An isomorphism in a category is a morphism F from X to Y for which there exists a morphism G from Y to X such that F and then G is the same as identity on X, and G and then F is the same as identity on Y. Here we say that F is an isomorphism and X and Y are isomorphic. Isomorphisms in the category of set are bijections. In categories group, ring, and field, the isomorphisms are bijective homomorphisms. And in the category of topological spaces, they are homeomorphisms. Pretty clear, right? But there are some things that are not so immediately apparent. A fun thing to think about are group objects. Groups are traditionally built on sets, along with a binary operation. But since we're now category theorists, we want to ask, can we generalize it to more complicated structures than sets? Turns out the answer is yes, of course. Given a category C, a group object in C is an object G in C together with morphisms that mimic multiplication, identity, and inverse operations, such that they satisfy the generalized versions of the group axioms. By this definition, a group object in the category set is a group. A group object in the category of groups is an abelian group, which can be proven using the observation that the inverse operation in the category of group is a group homomorphism, hence must be abelian. A group object in the category of topological spaces is a topological group. And finally, a group object in the category of smooth manifolds with smooth functions between them is precisely a Lie group. Now we have talked about morphisms that map between objects, let's bring it one level higher and talk about functors that map between categories. If morphisms are level 0 bridges, which are just rows, I guess, then morphisms would be our level 1 bridges that goes across categories. A functor f from category C to D maps objects to objects and morphisms to morphisms. In particular, a functor consists of an object fc in D for each object c in C, and a morphism ff that maps between objects in D for each morphism mapping between objects in C. The assignments need to satisfy the following two functorality axioms. For each composable pair f and g in C, we need ff before fg to be the same as f of g composed with f. And for each object c in C, we need f of the identity on A to be the same as the identity on fa. An example of a functor is the forgetful functor, a functor that forgets structure. For example, f being a functor from the category of group to the category of set sends a group to its underlying set and a group homomorphism to its underlying set map. A more interesting example is that the fundamental group defines a functor pi 1 from the category of topological spaces with fixed base points to the category of group. It sends a topological space to its corresponding fundamental group, and a continuous function in topstar induces a group homomorphism acting as the functor in group. This fact, interestingly, can be used to prove Brouwer's fixed point theorem, one of the versions of which roughly says that every continuous function from a closed disk onto itself has at least one fixed point. Fundamentally, functors are maps between categories that preserve categorical structure. Now we have arrows between objects called morphisms, arrows between categories called functors. As good category theorists, now we of course ask again, can we generalize? Indeed, there are arrows between functors called natural transformations, which, continuing with our analogy, would be bridges between bridges, I guess. And so what we have now is a two-category, in which our objects are categories, our morphisms are functors, and our functors are the maps between morphisms, aka natural transformations, which satisfy some properties, but don't worry about that. Of course, we could generalize these even further to three-category, four-category, or even infinity-category. In category theorist Emily Rieu's words, you can think of a category as providing a linguistic template for mathematical theory with nouns and verbs. But as the objects mathematicians study get more complicated, you need a more robust linguistic template with adjectives and adverbs and so on. That's the idea of an infinity category. Which, continuing with our bridge analogy, infinity category would be bridges between bridges between bridges ad infinitum? I think that might just be a plane. Yeah, it's falling apart. So before talking about universal properties, we have to talk about diagram categories, a wonderful illustration of our abstract nonsense. Fix an object A in a category C. Then we define a category C sub A, whose objects are morphisms with source A, and whose morphisms are commutative diagrams of this form. And it can be easily verified that this is a category. This kind of diagram category is immensely important in talking about universal properties. If you've studied abstract algebra, these theorems probably will look somewhat familiar to you. The first isomorphism theorem for groups, rings, and modules looks suspiciously similar. And indeed, behind the statements, we have three diagrams that look basically the same. And that's because they are basically the same thing. What this shows is the universal property of quotients in the category group, ring, and module, respectively. But what is a universal property, and how does it relate to the first isomorphism theorem? Well, let's look at the definition. An object A in a category C is called initial if for every object B there exists a unique morphism from A to B. And an object C is called final if for every object B there is a unique morphism from B to C. And if an object satisfies either of these properties, it is called universal. For now, we'll focus on the initial objects. Now let's observe the statement of the universal property of quotients. It says that let pi be our canonical projection, mapping x into its cosets under a given equivalence relation. Then for all homomorphism f from x to y, there exists a unique homomorphism f tilde from the quotient set to y, such that the diagram commutes. More concretely, if we have a set and a mapping pi that maps each element to its coset representative under the equivalence relation, and another map that also preserves its equivalence relation, then we must have a unique map here such that the diagram commutes. Now you might ask, why is this called the universal property? Which object is the universal object here? Well, in this diagram category, whose objects are arrows of this kind that preserve the equivalence relation, and whose morphisms are commutative diagrams, I claim that our projection map pi is an initial object in this category. And in fact, if we recall the definition of an initial object, it says that our object pi is initial if for every object f in our category, there exists a unique morphism from pi to f, which is precisely what our commutative diagram is saying. And since pi is an initial object, it is a universal object. In the special case when f is mapped to the image of f, this induced morphism is in fact an isomorphism because it happens to be injective and surjective. Therefore, we get an isomorphism between the quotient set and the image of f. In other words, an isomorphism between x mod the kernel of f and the image of f, which is precisely the statement of the first isomorphism theorem. And essentially, universal properties state that if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, then it must be a unique duck, up to unique isomorphism, of course. And this is immensely helpful. In fact, many objects are defined by their universal properties. We have product, coproduct, limit, colimit, inverse limit, etc., you name it. But if there's a commutative diagram, there's probably a universal property somewhere. So what is this abstract nonsense good for? Turns out, a lot of things. One of the really nice examples is a proof of the fact that the fundamental group of a topological group is abelian. A topological group is a topological space with a group structure. An example is a general linear group consisting of all invertible n-by-n matrices with real entries, which can be viewed as a topological group with topology defined by viewing it as a subspace of the Euclidean space R n cross n. This group itself is non-abelian, but its fundamental group is isomorphic to the integers with addition, which is abelian. The classical proof of this requires explicit computation to show that all paths in the topological group are abelian with respect to concatenation. However, here's a cute one-line proof using category theory. The fundamental group functor preserves products, hence it sends group objects to group objects. It sounds like abstract nonsense, but what it's really saying is that pi 1 serves as a functor from the category of topological spaces with fixed base points to group. The group objects in the category top star, as we discussed before, are topological groups, and the group objects in the category group are precisely the abelian groups. And since functor preserves products, it sends group objects to group objects. Then the fundamental groups of topological groups must also be abelian. As we can see, category theory makes obvious things obvious when the details obfuscate the specific case. This doesn't mean proofs using category theory are better or easier, but that category theory reveals the frame upon which the subject is built. You might notice that in this proof there's no construction to be found, and this is often the case with proofs using category theory. In our case, we simply whack our proof with a big hammer called functors preserve group objects. But to prove this hammer, we have to go into the nitty-gritty details. So while uncovering the structure and the foundation of the objects we're working with, proofs by category theory are often non-constructive. Another thing you might notice with category theory is that it is deeply algebraic. While it illustrates the connection between algebra, topology, and logic, you might ask, what about analysis or combinatorics? Of course, there are areas in analysis, such as function analysis, that makes use of category theory. But the truth is, category theory asks for abstraction, but feels like analysis does not always seek abstraction. In algebra, we focus on all topological spaces or all groups of a certain kind, and we want to know how they interact with each other. Whereas in analysis, we focus on particular spaces, for example, continuous or differentiable or analytic functions over C. So, as a wise man in Stack Exchange has said, while a screwdriver is a very useful tool to carry, you don't really need it if you're making a sandwich.